And it's my pleasure to welcome you all, both on the air and here at Concordia Academy in Roseville, Minnesota, to the first ever North Ramsey County Republicans gubernatorial debate. We're live on the air on AM 1280 The Patriot. We are live here at Concordia Academy, just north of Highway 36 on Dale Street in Roseville, Minnesota, for a joint venture with the North Ramsey County Republicans. Now, Brad Carlson, normally heard every Sunday afternoon from 1 to 3, co-hosting the debate with us here today. This debate being put on by the North Ramsey County Republicans, which includes House Districts 66A, and I believe 48A and 48B. 42A and 42B. I knew someone would correct me on that. So I'd like to express my appreciation to the North Ramsey County Republicans for putting this on the air. We have a good audience out here at Concordia Academy. Still have room for a few more if you happen to be driving around the Northeast Metro area. Again, on Dale Street, just north of Highway 36, about a block north, you see the Concordia Academy signs. You literally can't miss it. So it's my pleasure to welcome, of course, all of you to the audience here today, here at Concordia Academy, Brad Carlson and I. My pleasure to welcome the five of the six current candidates for the governor of the state of Minnesota joining us here at Concordia Academy. Marty Seifert joins us, Jeff Johnson, Rob Farnsworth, Dave Thompson, and Scott Honor are on the stage with us here today. I'd like to thank them all for showing up here today. We got a tight schedule to try and get through here today. We're going to try and do some long-form questioning to start things off, a speed round to wrap things up later on in the broadcast, about 20 minutes of discussion just here on stage, not for the debate consumption, just on the air, to wrap things up. But first and foremost, what we'd like to do is give each of the candidates 3 minutes to give an opening statement. And without any further ado, I would like to start off with our first candidate's opening statement. That would be current Hennepin County Commissioner, former Minnesota State Representative Jeff Johnson, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Rob tried to convince me that my first introduction was adequate, but I'm going to go on anyway and give you a little more information about myself. So thank you all for being here and for everything you do for the party. I'm Jeff Johnson. The quick background for those of you who don't know me, I grew up in northern Minnesota, as did my wife. We're from Detroit Lakes and Crookston. Went to Concordia College up in Moorhead, Minnesota. I spent most of my life in the private sector, but also during that time served for 6 years in the Minnesota House, and now the last 5 years as the often lone, often loud voice of some level of fiscal sanity on the Hennepin County Board. I am a lifelong Republican activist, an unapologetic fiscal and social conservative, although not in a loud or obnoxious sort of way, but more in a Norwegian Lutheran from northern Minnesota sort of way. I'm seeking your endorsement for governor of Minnesota, and I will honor that endorsement because I believe it matters, and I really believe that it is our best path to victory in November. And so today I'm going to ask for your support, but I also want to ask something else of you that I always ask at these forums, and that is, as you listen to us and as you watch us today, you don't just view us from your vantage point as a Republican activist, but you also try to put yourself in the shoes of your non-Republican neighbors and ask the question, what are they going to think of these guys? Are they going to like these guys? Are they going to trust these guys? Will they possibly want to vote for these guys? Because we are going to need, like it or not, we are going to need a lot of those non-Republican neighbors in order to win in November. And that doesn't mean we compromise our conservative principles. I've never done that, and I never will do that. But in order for us to win, in order for Republicans to win statewide in the state of Minnesota, it's not just enough for us to say, let's pick a solid conservative. We need to do more than that. We need to pick a solid conservative who can also make a personal connection with everyday Minnesotans who aren't Republicans and who can share a very positive, relevant, conservative vision that actually inspires people and makes them want to pick us over all of those promises that the Democrats are going to give them again over the next 8 months. So today, I just ask that you try on your neighbor's shoes for a few minutes because they are going to be crucial for us winning in November. So again, thank you for being here and for everything you do for the party, and I hope to earn your support. Thanks.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, our next candidate to give an opening statement will be Marty Seifert. Marty is a former minority leader in the House Republican Caucus and was a candidate for governor back in 2010 and spent a few years in the private sector, but he's back now. Marty Seifert.
Great, thanks. Thanks to Concordia Academy and AM 1280 The Patriot for having us this morning, this afternoon, for our meet and greet and our debate. My name is Marty Seifert. I am a candidate for governor. We have a very crucial election in front of us here in 2014. I obviously run for governor before. I came up short at the convention last time, but a little bit about me for those of you who have not been familiar with me. I am the youngest of six kids. I was raised on a farm in southern Minnesota. I'm a lifelong middle-class Minnesotan. I spent my whole life here. I'm the candidate with the Minnesota accent, they always joke, which I think is a good thing. My wife Tracy and I have two children, Brittany and Braxton. I have been a school teacher. I've been a university admission counselor. I've been a real estate agent. I've worked at a hospital as the foundation director. And last and least, I have been in the Minnesota House of Representatives. I was 3 years as the minority leader when Tim Pawlenty was governor of Minnesota. If you want to know more information about me, you can go to SeifertForGovernor.com. Unlike the Obamacare website, mine actually works. We have a lot of information about me and about my campaign on the website. Just a few information items about my candidacy. I am for downsizing government, just not making it a little more efficient. I am for abolishing the Met Council. I am for reducing the size, scope, power, taxation of the government so you can raise your own kids, your own family, in the way that you see fit and not having government make your decisions for you. On education, I am for more school choice, for parental involvement, for local control. I do not want the federal government involved in your education. It's not in the Constitution. Common Core, no child left behind. It doesn't matter if it's a Democrat or Republican idea. The federal government doesn't belong in our schools dictating our academic curriculum. And with health care, I can tell you, thank you. And with health care, I can tell you, working at a hospital for the last 3 years, that Obamacare and MnSure is a disaster. We could work out pre-existing conditions and insurance premium spikes without the government socializing 1/6 of our economy. And I've looked at people in the eyes who haven't had dollars to pay to get into the care that they need, and we work that out for them with charity care, uncompensated care. Minnesota had more people covered with health care than any state in the United States. We didn't need Obama and Dayton to come in and socialize the economy for it. Also, real quickly on transportation, I'm a road and bridge guy. That's how 95% of our population gets around. That's where the priority needs to be. The $1.5 billion Southwest Light Rail line for a few hundred people for 14 miles is ridiculous. It is not where dollars should be going in transportation. With that, thank you, God bless you, and God bless the great state of Minnesota. Thanks.
Our next candidate is currently the Senate Minority Leader, one of the Senate Minority Leaders, and before that, in addition to being an attorney, was a fellow Hubbard Broadcasting alumnus. Our next candidate, please welcome Senator Dave Thompson.
Thank you and good afternoon. Those of you who follow me on Twitter saw that apparently my 21-year-old snowblower has a lifespan of 20 years, and so it did not fire up this morning. And lo and behold, I look up, and as I've been pulling on the thing for a while and it doesn't work, I see my neighbor heading over with a snowblower. And 15 minutes later, my driveway was cleared, and I had given him a handshake and thanked him for what he did. And you know what occurred to me? He does know my politics, and I know his because we've talked, but generally, that kind of thing doesn't matter. You know, if my neighbor's snowblower wasn't working and mine was, I wouldn't ask if he or she were a Democrat, Republican, liberal, or conservative. I'd take my snowblower and help. So the question becomes, how do we win this election? And I think how we win this election is we treat people like people. And we care about people in a way that they relate to. And we bring to them the kinds of things that we believe in and the ideas that we have in such a way that they understand that it will make their lives better. I certainly believe in fiscal responsibility. I've stood for it in the Senate in the 3 years I've been there. I've preached it when I was on the radio. I certainly believe in robust education choice. I'm going to advocate strongly for large tuition tax credits or vouchers. My health care policy is rolled out. You can see it at teamthompsonmn.com on my website. I want to rely heavily upon the free market and restoring power in the medical relationship to the relationship between the doctor and the patient, not the relationship between the government bureaucrat and the insurance company. I believe all those things. But what's important is, can I talk to people in Minnesota in a way that they understand that their beliefs are very similar to mine, if not exactly the same as mine? And I think we can do that. Because, you know, access to a good education, whether or not you are born in the 4th Congressional District or the 5th Congressional District or Northern Minnesota or a suburb, doesn't matter. It's not a conservative value that all of those children should have access to a good education. It's a human value. It's a Minnesota value. And I think if we talk to people about that in a way that they see our compassion and they see our concern, they're going to vote for us. A healthy economy, so that people's children are likely to grow up, maybe go to college, maybe not, but settle here in Minnesota and want to be a part of this state, that's not a liberal or conservative value, that's a Minnesota value. All of these things are Minnesota values. So in terms of who do we think can win this thing, I think the people on this stage generally have a worldview that people will accept. We have to be willing and able to go out there and talk to people and convince them that we are concerned about them and that we want a good life for them, just like we want to help the neighbor whose snowblower breaks down. My name is Dave Thompson. I'd be honored by your support, and I will abide by your endorsement.
Okay, our next candidate to give his opening statement will be Scott Honor. Scott previously has not held elected office, but he has been a success in business for a number of years, and he'll share his story right now. So, Mr. Honor.
Great, thanks, Brad and Mitch. People have asked me, they've said, Honor, you're a business guy. What's prepared you for politics? Well, I once had a job shoveling horse manure at 5:30 every morning. I can't think of better preparation. Shortly after I announced I was running, I got a call from Tom, one of the dads in the Cub Scout den I led, and Tom said, I want to help support your campaign. He told me that ever since he came to Minnesota from Vietnam, he's considered himself to be a Democrat. But he's facing new challenges and his views are changing. Tom owns a nail salon, and he tells me he's been losing customers because taxpayers have been leaving the state and he's been losing revenues. Every year he's facing more regulations from government and it's creating a burden on his business. And Tom's driving 45 minutes each way so his kids can go to a good public school instead of the lousy school by where he lives. I'm proud to have Tom's support. And I think it's terrific that Tom's had a chance to live the American dream as I have and as I'm sure many in the room have. But I'm concerned that that opportunity to live the American dream is slipping away. I see the challenges that Tom faces as being caused in part by having a government that in many ways is working against him instead of for him. We have career politicians who spend their time focusing on what dollars we spend instead of the results we get. They accept mediocrity instead of striving for excellence. And unfortunately, we've had Republican leaders who, despite talking a good game, have failed to pass our agenda in a way that would help all Minnesota lives. I'm running for governor to help small business owners like Tom create opportunity for themselves and for the people who work for them. I understand what it takes to create jobs. In 1999, I started a business that today is the largest property rental payments company in the country. It has over 150 employees. Over the last decade, I bought and fixed 60 companies. I'll work hard to make sure that Minnesota has an environment that creates more jobs, better jobs, and rising wages. We'll do that by overhauling regulation, reforming taxes, and making Minnesota a right-to-work state. I'm running for governor to help parents like Tom. I want to see Minnesota be a state where our students have the best opportunity to pursue a career or go to college. I'll work to make sure that we have a system where dollars follow students to offer more choices to parents. Eliminate the tenure system so schools can hire the best teachers and reward them. And get waste out of administrative costs and put it into the classroom. And ultimately, I'm looking to apply my leadership skills to have our state achieve better results with fewer dollars and see Minnesota live up to her full potential.
Candidate
to introduce himself today. Hails from Chisholm, Minnesota. He is a graduate of the University of St. Thomas. He's a special ed teacher in Hibbing, Minnesota. Please welcome Rob Farnsworth.
Well, thank you for having me here today. It's good to be here, and it's really good to see all of the students up in that corridor. When I was in high school, I thought I was one of the few that was interested in this sort of thing, so it's good to see that large of a group here. As you said, I'm from Hibbing, drove up from Hibbing this morning. It's good to be here. I live in Hibbing with my beautiful wife, Jamie, and our three children, Hannah, Isaac, and Abigail, and all three of them are sick today, so my wife is a saint letting me come here today and staying home with three sick kids. I actually lived down here for about 4 years. I attended college at the University of St. Thomas. My first teaching job was pretty close to here at Mounds View High School. After I taught at Mounds View, I taught for the Minnesota Department of Corrections at two juvenile facilities for about 6 years. And now I'm teaching special education in Hibbing. I'm a bit of an unusual Republican. I'm the son of a 33-year union miner. I'm a teacher in the teachers union, and my wife is a union nurse, and I have remained a steadfast constitutional conservative. And sometimes I ask myself, what business does a teacher from Hibbing have to do running for governor? Here's the thing. As a teacher, I have seen teachers in both private, in correctional facilities, in public education, and we have teachers that are the best in the world. But our legislature is forcing our teachers to try and put square pegs into round holes. We're trying to prepare 100% of our students to go to a four-year college and university. And that is just setting our teachers up to fail. We can prepare our students so that they can have a unique education and they will actually be ready for life. We can have our students walk out of high school with 2 years of college done and paid for at no additional cost to the taxpayer, and students would have zero student loans, so if they went on to college, they would only have 2 years to pay for. Those students that don't want to go to a four-year college and university, we could have them walk out of high school with a technical degree, partner with our technical schools and our high schools, so the kids can walk out and work and make money and pay taxes and have zero student loans and not pay any interest to Wells Fargo and San Francisco. And the third group, kids that won't go to technical school, wouldn't go to a four-year college university, we can prepare for life with work skills and life skills. Now, I haven't been a special ed teacher at Hibbing my whole career. Like I said, I taught for the Department of Corrections. And this has given me a unique insight. One of the questions that I would like to ask you is, why would we consider allowing politicians in St. Paul to make Minnesota less safe? And as a former correctional employee, I have seen this from the inside. And my question, why would we even consider allowing somebody who has sexually harmed a child to get out of prison? Hopefully I'll get a chance to talk about this more and about other issues, but I see that my time is running out. So thank you.
Okay, great. Well, we appreciate the opening statements. Fascinating. And we want to now move ahead. We do have some questions. And incidentally, folks, if you do have some questions you'd like asked, write them down. And we have a gentleman waving in the back, Mr. Zierman waving in the back. Any questions you'd like submitted, we will definitely take them on. Fantastic. Okay, they're definitely flowing in now. Terrific. Okay, what we are going to do is we are going to ask a series of questions here, and initially the format is that each candidate will have an opportunity, 60 seconds, is that correct? 60 seconds opportunity to respond, and we'll take it from there. So what I'm going to do is, it's my purview of how I would like the order in which the candidates respond. We'll go in alphabetical order, so I believe Mr. Farnsworth would be first up for this particular question. And we did hear a lot about education in the opening statements of each of the candidates, so this one is sort of in line with that. We must have every child of school age in a school. Our goal as governor, what will you do to have that happen, to take steps to reach that goal? Sort of a broad education question. Mr. Farnsworth, it was kind of bouncing off the end of your opening statement there. If you want to start off with that, we'd appreciate it. So what will you do to have that happen for every school-age child to be properly educated? So kind of a broad question, I realize.
Well, I think we have to, first of all, look at all of the options. And at first, I sort of misunderstood your question as that we have to have all of the kids in school, which I don't think they all have to be in school because I am a supporter of the homeschool movement. And so I think that that's one avenue. But again, you know, I talked about how we're trying to educate 100% of our high school students to go to a four-year college and university. And I touched on this a little bit, but one of the benefits, and this would be sort of to answer part of this question, is how do we keep kids in school? We have a too high of a dropout rate for our minority students in Minnesota. Imagine minority students if we tell them when you hit 11th grade, you either are going to be taking a full college load or you have the opportunity. You can take a technical program when you graduate high school, you're going to be able to get a $15 an hour job as a welder, or you're going to have work experience, maybe an apprenticeship. My guess is that those students that would be more likely to drop out would say, yeah, I'm going to stick it out. I don't want to make minimum wage. If I walk out of high school with a technical degree, I'm going to be able to make a good living. And that's one of the steps that I would do that would keep kids in school.
Scott Arnold.
Thanks. Yeah, my wife Jamie and I support KIPP, which is a charter school in North Minneapolis. It operates at a 25% lower cost per student, pays teachers 16% more, and the students have 2 times better test scores. We should be doing more of that. When I talked to the head of school there and asked him about what challenges he faces, he told me about how they want to expand and build a grade school. Right now it's just a middle school, but in Minnesota it's illegal for a charter school to own real estate. I mean, what is this, Russia? It makes no sense. We need to have a government that's working for how we create more choices for parents, not inhibiting schools to grow and succeed. I've gotten to know the governor of Louisiana. He's put forth one of the smartest plans in the country of using school vouchers. I want to see us do that here in this state. Have a system where we offer more choice to parents.
Jeff Johnson.
Two answers to this. Number one, it's all about choice and options for parents, because what works for one kid does not necessarily work for another kid, and what works for one school district does not necessarily work for another. And we've had this cookie cutter approach at the state for years, since I was in the legislature, of saying the state should determine, or worse yet, the feds should determine what the curriculum is or what sort of policies we should have in each school. And so that means providing a lot of options for parents, whether it is the traditional public school, whether it's a charter school, whether it's a home school, whether there's some online learning involved. The other piece that is really important to always note, and it's one of the three priorities that I talk about wherever I go, is the educational achievement gap, that disparity between white students and students of color in Minnesota. It's the worst in the nation in this state, and that is shameful, and it's shocking, and we need a governor who's willing to take that head on, and that probably means a rather public battle with the education establishment and the teachers union about parental empowerment and real school choice, but that's something we absolutely have to have.
Marty Seifert.
I've been a public school teacher myself, and in a lot of cases, politicians think they're better educators than educators are. That's probably the first recognition that we need to understand when the legislature is not the state school board. Number two, obviously we need to empower parents for more choices. My kids go to parochial school. My kids, myself, my wife, our siblings, our parents all went to parochial schools. No, we don't do that because we think our public schools are horrible in Minnesota. We do it because that's part of my faith, and we want those faith tenets as part of our education. But obviously school choice is part of it. Keeping the federal government out of our schools, public, parochial, homeschool, etc. That includes Common Core, that includes No Child Left Behind. Minnesotans know how to run their schools. I think it also involves academic quality, academic instruction time. Our kids in the public schools right now spend less time for academic instruction than any time in Minnesota history. I had a study conducted about that. And the illogic of this is that long term, we're gonna have kids in school fewer and fewer academic times for more and more money. Makes no sense.
And finally, Senator Thompson.
Well, first off, I want our public schools to succeed. I got all of my formal education in public schools. But you know, we as Americans believe that iron sharpens iron, that competition makes everybody rise to a higher level and produce a better product or service. Why should that not apply to schools? And that is why I have spent a good part of my public life on radio and TV and in the legislature advocating for school choice. And I believe that if students and parents are given an option, and if we make a robust amount of money as a part of these choices, or a part of these tuition tax credits or vouchers, that there will be a supply of schools that will come in and create the kind of competition that you see between Target and Walmart and McDonald's and Burger King. And I think that high tide will raise all boats. So I'm not going to allow myself to be pigeonholed into the idea that this is an anti-public school move. It is not. It is an attempt to raise the education for all students in Minnesota, school choice, and if that means pushing hard against the unions, we'll have to do that.
All right. By the way, when we get through with all five candidates, if anyone has a cross-examination question, just raise your hand and grab my attention, and we'll work our way into that here as we go, because that could get fun. Second question, this one's from the audience, and by the way, feel free to keep the questions coming to the BPOU chairs. What do you think are the three most important qualifications for the governor of the state of Minnesota? Is it political experience, integrity? Are they God-fearing? Do they have business experience? Is it the looks? What are the three most important qualifications for the governor of the state of Minnesota? We'll start with Jeff Johnson.
That's a great question. I would start out with saying integrity. To me, that is the most important quality in almost any position that you hold. And you have to have that integrity, you have to have a history in that integrity, and voters and citizens have to believe that you have that integrity. Number two, I think experience helps. I don't think it is a prerequisite, because I think having some outside real world non-political experience as I have had is also crucial. But I think, especially considering the fact that the DFL Senate is not up for election this year, we are guaranteed, if we have a Republican governor, to still have politically divided government. And I think you need somebody who can step in there, who has some experience and has a record of actually getting conservative things done, even when Democrats control part of the government. And then I believe that an actual record of accomplishing legislation, so that you can show that to people and show that you're actually in there to change something and make government work, is a big plus for any of us as a candidate for governor. And I do have that experience.
Next up will be Scott Honor. After the applause.
Well, I think it starts with leadership skills overall. I think that we have to have a governor that knows how to lead from the front and has a history of actually accomplishing things in a leadership role. And in Minnesota, I think we have to understand how to communicate with our citizens. In order to get the job done, we need to start by communicating with the state as a whole what our objectives are and how we're going to achieve them. So I think we need to have a leader that is also a good communicator and knows how to present the vision of the state in a way that Minnesotans will understand and get behind. And then ultimately, I think it's having actual experience and proven experience in achieving results. It's not just enough to have the rhetoric. We have to have a leader in this state who has gotten things done.
Next up, we will go to Dave Thompson.
Vision, consistency, and the ability to lead. If you don't have the right vision, nothing else matters. I envision a Minnesota in which there's a healthy economy and employers want to come here and grow their businesses and create a better state where people are employed and people get a good education. Consistency, in that these are the things that you've stood for and stood behind and been willing to stand for in the face of adversity all of your life. Those are the kinds of things that I have stood for and I have been willing to do. Finally, and this is very critical, there are those in positions of leadership, and there are those who lead. And leading, I think, is comprised of two things. Number one, you've got to be able to get people to buy into the vision so that we can move Minnesota forward in a unified fashion and create a better future for all of us. But you also have to understand the people that you're leading and be respectful of where they are and where they can be taken and where they cannot. Those would be the three things I consider most important.
Up next, Rob Farnsworth. Do you need the question again?
No, I know the question. Okay. It was Marty's turn.
We're randomizing things as we go here, so just to keep you on your toes.
Well, not to copy Jeff, but I think that integrity is probably the most important thing that we need in a leader. And the reason I say that is, as I travel around, as I talk to everyday people, I hear all too often people say, well, all those politicians are the same. They're all crooks. And I think it's time that we send leaders to St. Paul that people can trust. And when they leave St. Paul, people still say, yeah, that person had integrity. They were honest. They always stood by their values. I think we also need somebody with varied experience. It doesn't necessarily have to be experience in the legislature, but business experience, government experience, experience, you know, enduring poverty, I think, are certain experiences that we need for leaders to understand what people are going through. And finally, I think that the leader needs to be somebody, given that we are going to have Democrats in control of the Senate, we have to be able to work across the aisle. We have to be able to work with the other party so that we don't have government shutdowns, because those always tend to backfire on us.
Finally, Marty Seifer.
I think a wide variety of experience is important. I've been a lifelong middle-class Minnesotan. We have to run a candidate who understands the average middle-class Minnesota budget. The average Minnesotan in this state will see their discretionary disposable income go backwards in the next year. I understand that. We pay our own health insurance. I'm not a member of the legislature right now. I'm not independently wealthy. I know how it feels. I know how the average person feels out there. We need someone who can stand on stage with Mark Dayton and make that articulation. Honesty is obviously very important. As a member of the legislature and as a candidate for governor, I have never taken a contribution from a lobbyist, ever, and never will. And I think that is a unique part of what I bring to this conversation, is that people are very cynical about politics. I got elected in a district that was carried regularly by Democrats, but I got reelected with 60 to 70% of the vote. You have to be able to communicate with people who are not just Republicans, and I've been proven to do that.
Fantastic, thank you. We are going to move on to the next question. And the Democrats at both the national and state level are making income inequality a primary issue. I'll start in random order again. We'll start with Scott Honor. How will you respond to this particular issue that Democrats are touting there is such an income inequality, and does government even have a role in trying to fix this? Scott Honor, we'll start with you.
Well, I do think that we need to make helping Minnesotans have a hand up to improve their levels of income a high priority. I want to focus on making sure that we have an environment that creates more jobs, better jobs, and rising wages in a way that helps all Minnesotans, including those at the very bottom end of the socioeconomic spectrum. We're going to do that by implementing our principles. We need to create an environment that's creating more jobs in this state. We're chasing companies out of the state. We're chasing taxpayers out of the state. And I'll put in place a plan to turn us back the other way and have this state be competitive regionally, nationally, and globally. We'll do that by overhauling regulation and taxes, making Minnesota a right-to-work state, and creating a level playing field that creates opportunity for all Minnesotans.
Marty Seifer.
Well, I look at it as an opportunity equality issue. We want an equality of opportunity for every single person in the state. I was up last week testifying on the PolyMet project in northern Minnesota, which is going to provide over $1 billion of new revenue for this state. Truck drivers, PhD engineers, and everywhere in between. Those are the type of good jobs with health insurance and good pay that we need added in this state. The Democrats like to make a lot of issues about the rich didn't pay their fair share and the poor and the middle class are being left behind. I can tell you one thing is that they were about half right. The issue is that we needed to reduce taxes on the working class, the middle class, and those who are left behind. Not raise taxes on someone else and try to distribute it out through some type of a welfare program. We need to be about opportunity, we need to be about good education, and more jobs for more people in this state, and therefore they can move themselves up along the economic rung that we all want so people can prosper and raise their own families and not have the government do it for them.
Dave Thompson.
Their solutions haven't worked. We just hit the 50-year anniversary of the War on Poverty. And yet the very people who advocate for these ideas tell us our poverty problem is worse than it has ever been. Their ideas don't work. And secondly, the issue really isn't income inequality. The issue is that we want high tide to raise all boats, that we want a society in which we have a healthy job market, we have a healthy employment market, employers are doing well, and we want everybody to improve and succeed. And this idea that we're going to talk about the income disparity, Barack Obama stands up and talks about how much worse it is now than it was a few years ago. He's been running the country for 5 years. Why did he fix it? Their solutions don't work. And if we talk about freedom and choice and the ability to pursue your own goals and desires, the ability to start and grow a company without being encumbered by a morass of government regulations and taxes that take you down, we got to offer a positive vision and we'll succeed.
Jeff Johnson?
Well, I pray that they try to make that an issue this year, because we ought to make it our issue. We ought to do the same thing when they talk about poor schools and the education achievement gap. They control everything in Minnesota right now, and they're going to turn around and say, look at how bad things are. Well, you throw it back in their face, and you talk to the people who believe that there is a level of income inequality, and you say, how are their policies working out for you? They're obviously not working. And then you offer the alternative. Because, you know, when people talk about the minimum wage to me, my response is, first of all, when you arbitrarily raise the minimum wage, it tends to hurt the people that you claim to be trying to help, which are the youngest people and the people with the least skills, least marketable skills. But if we are actually able to fix the economy, we will start creating real jobs, and the minimum wage will be irrelevant, because the market is going to demand a minimum wage higher than what it is right now. So if you free up entrepreneurs to actually want to start and expand businesses here, which is exactly the opposite of where we are right now, income inequality is going to disappear.
And we'll wrap this question up with Rob Farnsworth.
The best thing that the government can do to deal with income inequality is to get the heck out of the way. I live in Hibbing. I grew up in the 80s when the mines were opening and closing. I remember a time when we had one jar of peanut butter and three-day-old bread. People need jobs. And those on the left would say, we can't open mines where there are billions of dollars and hundreds of jobs. They haven't lived it. They haven't lived day to day. So the government needs to get out of the way so that businesses can create jobs. I'm going to touch on this a million more times, but the other thing the government can do is fundamentally reform education, and it will impact the education achievement gap. If we have kids walking out of high school ready to get a good job, not a minimum wage job, but a good job that they can support their family with, we will not have this so-called inequality. Just to wrap it up, there are those that say we need to raise the minimum wage by $2 because that's going to make people a little less poor. I don't want people a little less poor. I want people to go into the middle class to be able to support themselves.
We're at the North Ramsey County Republican Debate live on AM 1280 The Patriot, also being held live here at Concordia Academy in Roseville, just north of Highway 36 on Dale Street. If you're in the neighborhood, please stop on by. Our next question, since we are on the outskirts of St. Paul, deep in the heart of Betty McCollum's corner of Minnesota, the next question is, the Republican Party has a reputation of being the party of white, upper middle class males. What would you do in your campaign and as governor to try and get outside of the that cliche or stereotype? And we'll start this off with Dave Thompson.
Well, I think first off, I alluded to this in my opening remarks when I said that we have to talk about things that people care about in a way that they understand we're sincere. I've been talking about education for over a decade now on radio, TV, and now in this campaign and in the legislature. I think the way that we get to people in the 4th and 5th congressional district is we talk about the fact that we are going to provide a system of education that will offer their children access to a quality education and give them their shot at the American dream. Because let's face it, the American dream is an illusion. If you're not able to read, write, and do arithmetic at a level that allows you to get a good job and take care of your family. As far as talking to middle class and upper middle class folks, we've got to get into the Iron Range and talk about the possibilities up there with the mining, getting this permitting moved and that sort of thing. And then obviously we've got to address our farm economy. I come from northwestern Minnesota where the farm economy drove us. And we've got to pay attention to those things. And if we do, and we talk to people about what's important to them, we can get those votes.
Next up, we'll go to Rob Farnsworth.
Well, I'm perfect for that because I'm not upper middle class, I'm just middle class, so that'll help. You know, we need to, as a Republican Party, I think one thing that we've been lacking until recently is that we sort of have been perceived as a good old boys club. And I think it's time that we start reaching out to those groups, start inviting them to caucus, start having dialogue with, you know, the non-WASP, you know, whatever term you want to use, groups in Minnesota. Because a lot of those new Americans, those new Minnesotan people that come from outside the country, they share our values. But when they get here, the first people that reach out to them, you know, would be Democrats. And we need to get to them. We need to say, this is what we believe in. This is America, the land of opportunity. We're the Growth and Opportunity Party. We believe in opening things up so that you have opportunity to start a business, to go to college, and to live the American dream. And if we get that message to those groups, I believe we will win.
Next we go to Scott Honor.
Thanks. You know, I feel like I've lived the American dream. When I was born in Fridley, my family lived in a trailer park. When I grew up in Mound, my dad lost his job and lost his pension. But we got through that, and I worked a number of minimum wage jobs to put myself through college and ultimately create financial security for my family. And I feel blessed in having had that opportunity. I believe that parents across this state want that same thing for themselves and for their children. And our principles are the best way to have them have that opportunity to achieve the American dream. And so, to me, it's just simply a matter of getting out there, of speaking with everyone, of having them understand that we've got solutions that are going to create opportunity for more jobs, better jobs, and rising wages, that we're going to create an education system that has this state the best place in the country to pursue a career or go to college. And that is what people in this state are looking for.
Up next, Marty Seifert.
I'm the youngest of six kids raised on a farm by a dad who had an eighth grade education. We born in corn cobs to keep my family warm in the wintertime. So I think I have a pretty good feeling of how people feel as they come into Minnesota, looking for opportunities, and that's really what people are looking for. When I campaigned for the legislature, I would go to adult basic education classes. This is people who are refugees and non-citizens looking to learn to read, write, and speak English, become citizens, learn the Constitution, legally get their driver's license, and then get education to work. Exactly what we want as Republicans, but that's what Democrats want too, just a different way of doing it. We need to show up. When I ran for governor last time, I went to the Sabathany Community Center in South Minneapolis. And there was a lady there who had worked for 40 years, and she said, "You are the first Republican I've seen here ever since the 1970s. They have a zoo day at Sabathany. She saw more zoo animals than Republicans show up at the Sabathany Community Center. We need to show up if we're going to get people's votes. And I've been very good about that, whether it's the Iron Range, the farm, the inner city, or elsewhere.
And finally, Jeff Johnson.
The key is showing up, but it's not about showing up next summer after we have a nominee. It's about showing up now, and frankly, it's about all of us showing up a year ago and 2 years ago and 4 years ago. And it's something that I've been trying to do on the Hennepin County Board for the last 5 years, because we do have an opportunity here. A lot of the new immigrants that are coming in are entrepreneurs. They want to start a little business, and they want their kids to get a better education, and they are socially conservative. But they are told by their leadership that we all hate them, and that we don't want them to succeed. And when they get to know you, when you show up over time, not at the very end, but over time, it's harder for them to believe that you're an evil person. And their response is, "Hey, wait a second, Jeff Johnson showed up 2, 3, 4 times, and we talked to him, and we think he actually does care about us." So it's about showing up and trying to, as best you can, go to their community. It's not about giving them a seat at our table. It's about trying to get a seat at their table and letting them know who you are and finding out what their needs are. And that will help more than anything else we can do.
Okay, a couple of questions ago we did talk a little bit about income equality, and a lot of the answers that I had heard was essentially trying to encourage businesses to stay and therefore businesses being able to expand, thus creating more jobs. So this question is more along the lines of the how to encourage that kind of creativity. And here's one from a student here. In a day when the economy is tight and citizens are hesitant to take risks, how exactly would you promote creativity and entrepreneurship in the next generation? Dave Thompson, we'll start with you.
Well, I think first of all, the reason that a lot of people feel that way is we have had elected officials and others talking America down and talking Minnesota down. How many times have you heard this governor pick a group of people that he says are exploiting the rest of us, and that because of what they are doing, we are not able to get ahead? And other members of the legislature that are in his party do the same thing, and the punditry on the left does the same thing. So first of all, we have to encourage people and help young people to understand that this still is the land of opportunity. And then as Milton Friedman once said, talking to Phil Donahue, no system known to man has been able to improve the lot of the ordinary citizen like the entrepreneurial endeavor unleashed in capitalism. So help people to believe that they can do it. And then secondly, we've got to follow through on our promise and create an environment in which that success can happen. And that's where we talk about reducing the amount of regulation, reducing the amount of taxes, and making our tax system smarter. So encourage people and then create a system in which they can thrive.
Next up, Scott Honor.
Well, I've started companies. I started a business in 1999 that's now the largest property rental payments company in the country with over 150 employees. What we have to do is make Minnesota an environment where people want to start those sort of businesses here. Today, we don't have that environment. We rank last place in the country in startups. I was speaking to a friend named Mike down in Prior Lake a while back. Mike recently started a new insurance business. He went to the Minnesota Insurance Commissioner and asked for a license and was told that the process would take him 2 years. He went to South Dakota and had his license in 10 days. We need to have a regulatory environment that fosters growth. Imagine a Minnesota with no 3M, with no Medtronic. That's the kind of state we have today. We have to have a fair tax system. We can't use taxpayer dollars to bribe companies in while chasing the companies that are here out. I'll make sure that we have a smart system that's creating the sort of growth opportunity here that all Minnesotans deserve to have.
Marty Seifert?
I think it's a little bit complicated, but I'll try to pound it in here. Number one is increasing people's average discretionary disposable income so they have the dollars to actually put into starting a business. That means fixing this healthcare issue, which is the cruelest tax that I've seen on people when they have 20, 30, 40% premium increases because of Barack Obama and Mark Dayton. We need to cut fees and regulation. In Minnesota right now, to open a distillery, it costs $30,000 for a license. $30,000. In Iowa, it's less than $500 for the same license. So you know where they're gonna go. This is on and on with various types of businesses in Minnesota. We also need good education. If we have poor education, we can have all the disposable income and tax cuts you want. We have to have that too. Medtronic was started in a garage of a couple guys. And under the Obama-Dayton economy, we're now seeing people live in their parents' garage rather than inventing things in their parents' garage.
Next up, Jeff Johnson.
When I was growing up in northwestern Minnesota, the big concern was that once kids graduated in North Dakota, they all moved to Minnesota. We've got our kids moving to North Dakota. The world is upside down because this is a better place to live, but we've made it so unfriendly for entrepreneurs. So you start with changing the law, and it comes, everybody's talked about this. It comes through tax reform, it comes through regulatory reform, it comes through lawsuit reform, I believe, and also an end to kind of an obsession with granting special favors to a few businesses at the expenses of all the other. That's not pro-business to me. But also, it comes in a tone or a climate that the leader of your state sets. And I think if we have a governor who actually celebrates success and welcomes people who want to take risks and makes it easier for them to do that, rather than constantly tries to punish them or look down with them or talk them down, that is going to encourage investment in entrepreneurs more than anything else we can do.
And last responded, Rob Farnsworth.
And I just want to be clear, the question is, how do we encourage entrepreneurship in the next generation?
Yes.
Okay. Imagine with me a student in Minneapolis. Now, this student loves robotics and would thrive, say, at Dunwoody in their robotics program. But we're saying, no, we're going to give you an education that prepares you to go to a four-year college or university. Imagine if this same student, when they graduate, after doing, you know, the regular high school career, they say, oh, forget it, I hate school, I'm not going on, and I'm not going to do that. But imagine while they were in high school, if we partnered with Dunwoody so that that kid could take robotics classes at Dunwoody. When he's done with high school, he's got all of the knowledge, he can work, but he also likes to tinker on things, could invent something. That is how we foster it, by allowing kids to have their unique education, not preparing every student for the same future. And then everybody else talked about it. We need to get rid of the regulations. Once he invents this, he needs to be able to get it to market. He or she, sorry, needs to get it to market so that he or she can make money. And we also need to remind people that success is not a bad thing. If you invent something, you should be able to reap the benefits of what you have invented.
All right, what we're going to do here is go through one more question, take a brief break so we can get some sponsors in here, let you all stretch your legs a little bit, then we'll go to the lightning round. But first, we're going to cover the opposite side of the spectrum from entrepreneurship. Minnesota's government has been fairly described as a human services bureaucracy with a legislature tacked onto the end. What would your administration, should you be elected, do with respect to getting our human services bureaucracy under control? Let's start with Rob Farnsworth.
I thought about this a lot, and there are a couple of steps that I would make. First, I believe that money that is spent at the most local level is spent most responsibly. I believe that all of social services should be provided at the county level. And so what I would propose is that we cut taxes, and specifically we cut the sales tax. The sales tax in 1967 was 3%, now we're at almost 7%. If we cut the sales tax while at the same time cutting health and human service budget, now some people are going to say, oh, Republicans, you just want to take away from the poor. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is we're going to cut the budget, but we're going to tell counties we're also cutting the sales tax so that you have the flexibility to provide the services that you need, so that if, say, Kitson County in Northwest Minnesota doesn't need as much social service money, they might raise their sales tax 1%. They have the flexibility. Right now, counties get money either from local government aid or from property taxes. We need to give them flexibility to raise that money at the local level, spend it at the local level, and keep the middleman of state government out of it.
Up next, we'll go to Jeff Johnson.
Well, we are still, you know, there was welfare reform in Minnesota 10 and 15 years ago, but we are still an outlier when you compare comparable states with respect to what we spend on human services versus other programs. But I don't think our message can be we're going to cut human services by 10% or 4% or 12%, because that scares Minnesotans. I think what we need to do and what we need to constantly be talking about is, first, we have to figure out what government should be doing. But then once we make that decision, we should figure out which programs are actually working and are actually doing what we claim we want them to do. And one of the three things that I've been talking about as a goal has been to start auditing the programs that taxpayers fund in Minnesota. We start with human service programs because they're easiest to measure. This is my life on the county board right now, and that is where most of our human services programs flow through counties. And those programs that are actually changing people's lives and helping them move off of welfare, we should celebrate those programs. But the many programs that we fund because they make us feel good but are ineffective, those are the ones that we need to end, and that will get this under control better than anything else we could do.
Up next, Marty Seifert.
Well, we have a big job in taking on the welfare industrial complex in the state, and I'm going to start by the welfare industrial complex at the state level. The health and human services departments are separate. Even though the federal government, as wasteful and inefficient as they are, have them under one house, and you can reduce an enormous amount of costs. We need a waiting period for welfare. We have people that move to Minnesota, you might be shocked at this, and enroll in welfare programs almost immediately, coming from other places who are non-Minnesotans. Those dollars are for our fellow Minnesotans who are on tough times. We don't want to have a magnetic effect. In working at a hospital, I've seen people who haven't had the dollars to pay for health care. There are a lot of opportunities for us. People that go to urgent care with things like ear infections, urinary tract infections, bee stings, mild lacerations. In Marshall, Minnesota, at our urgent care, it costs $68 to go see a nurse practitioner to take care of such things. At the emergency room for the same thing, it's $680. A 90% cost difference. If we can pre-triage people, you can save a lot of money and you can still take care of people. That's what we need to do as Republicans.
Up next, Scott Honor.
Well, I think we have to start by instilling a sense of culture in government that has government thinking of it, its job is to serve the citizens as the customers and owners of government. We have to have the right leadership overseeing all functions in government. And in health and human services, we need to do smart things and take examples of what's been done effectively elsewhere. I've gotten to know the governor and lieutenant governor of Kansas, Sam Brownback and Dr. Jeff Collier. In Kansas, they partnered with the private sector to lower their Medicaid costs by 10% and improve outcomes to their Medicaid recipients. It's a very effective system. We ought to be doing more things like that here in our government and taking the best ideas we can find from around the country to figure out how do we improve outcomes and lower costs for all Minnesotans.
And finally, Senator Thompson.
I think it was Cicero who said our most common form of ignorance is forgetting our objective. What is the objective of Health and Human Services? It's to take care of the truly needy. We are good people. We are not going to let our young, our infirm, and our elderly suffer. But the second objective is to make those who can be made independent to be independent, so they're not dependent on our system forever. So there are all kinds of examples that we can give, but in a 60-second answer, what I can tell you is we have to look and ask ourselves, are people the beneficiaries of government benefits that should not be, that are not entitled to them, that don't qualify for them, but because of the lax system that we have, they're getting them. If so, we need to tighten that up. And I believe in independent outside audits to do that. I actually authored a bill that dealt with dependence of government employees, and we did that. And then secondly, any program that encourages dependency, or that we see the vast majority of participants end up in long-term dependency, get rid of it and promote those programs that give people an opportunity to get out.
All right, that's the first half done here. What we're going to do is take a break right now, come back with the lightning round, and then go to the closing statements here. So going to take a 5-minute break right now. We'll be coming back with the lightning round. Get up, stretch your legs. If you're in the audience, grab something to drink. The fun is just beginning. Northern Alliance Radio Network, AM 1280 The Patriot. We'll be right back. Welcome back, Twin Cities and World. It's the program that says, send us your tired, huddled masses yearning to see red. The Northern Alliance Radio Network, brought to you this Saturday, as every Saturday, by Thompson Building Remodeling. On the web at thompsonpros.com. He's a local guy from here in Roseville. You gotta love him. Go to thompsonpros.com, check out the reference jobs, give Jeff O'Mara a call, tell him Mitch Berg and Brad Carlson sent you. He'll know exactly who you're talking about. They got a lot of business of us. Thompson Building and Remodeling. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We're here for the second half of the Northern Alliance Saturday broadcast, the first ever Northern Ramsey County Republicans gubernatorial debate. Brad Carlson, normally heard every Sunday from 1 to 3, and I, Mitch Berg, heard Saturday normally from 1 to 3 at this time slot on AM 1280 The Patriot. Hosting the debate, we have the five current gubernatorial candidates from the Republican Party as we head toward the caucus time. Marty Seifert, Jeff Johnson, Rob Farnsworth, Dave Thompson, and Scott Honor are joining us here at Concordia Academy, just north of Highway 36 on Dale Street in Roseville. Go about a block north of 36, look for all the big signs that say Concordia Academy. That's a sign you're getting warm. Stop in the auditorium. We'd love to see you. By the way, after the event here today, we're going to be having meet and greets in the gym just down the hall from the auditorium here. We've got candidates with their tables set up. You can meet them face-to-face. Ask any questions we can't squeeze on the air here. Now, we're going to get through a lightning round, as many questions as we can, trying to keep the candidates to 30 seconds at a pop here. Although, if you have any cross-examination, jump in fast, because let's face it, like any broadcaster, I like to watch a good rumble. So feel free to jump in, but keep it polite. And we'll jump off on that right now. So Brad Carlson, you have the con.
Okay, fantastic. We'll start with Marty Seifer. This question just goes straight down the line, so no randoms here. It is important to Minnesotans to have a leader who is true to their personal convictions. How do you see your faith as a factor in making political decisions?
Well, faith is very important to me. My wife and I are practicing Catholics. We find that one of the fundamental underpinnings of what started our country was faith and freedom. When we get sworn in, we say, "So help me God," for a reason, not just for rhetoric. And so if we look at the uniqueness of our country and how it was founded, it's not a king, it's not a monarch, but the Lord's in charge. There's a reason the cathedral is a few inches taller than the Capitol building. It wasn't an accident.
My faith, which are really my values, direct every decision I make. Now, I'm a Norwegian Lutheran, and so I don't wear it on my sleeve very well, and nor do I want to, because that's how I was brought up. But to me, everybody's faith, regardless of what it is a very important part of who they are, and I think it is crucial that you also factor that into all the decisions you make as a governor or as a legislator.
Thank you, Jeff Johnson. Rob Farnsworth.
Well, as a Christian, my Christian faith does mold who I am. It molds my perspective. But more than that, the Judeo-Christian tradition is something that has molded this country. And that's not a bad thing. You know, we've done pretty well with the Judeo-Christian heritage. And I believe that's something that we can continue to benefit from. You know, my morals, my ethics are shaped by my faith, and similar to the way that our nation has been shaped by those similar morals and ethics.
Dave Thompson?
The moral left has done us a lot of disservices, but none greater than perpetuating the idea that morality is relative, that there are no absolutes. I believe, based upon my faith, I am a Christian, I believe that there are moral absolutes, that those absolutes transcend human thought and human thinking, and that the moment we get away from those kinds of things, we go down a bad path. And anyone who tells you that their own personal morality doesn't inform their politics will lie to you about other things. Because we all build our ideas of what is right in policy based on what we believe is right in life.
Scott.
My college alma mater's motto is "Freely ye received, freely give." And that's guided me in many ways as to why I'm running for governor, because I want to help make this state better for everyone. And ultimately, there'll be decisions that I'll rely on the Judeo-Christian values that I hold as the core value system about which I'm relying on making decisions.
Okay, next question, 30 seconds a pop here. We'll start again on this end and work our way down. Why you? Why do you want to be governor? Why should you be governor? Marty Seifert.
Well, it's real simple. I can do a better job than Mark Dayton, although that's a very low bar, quite frankly. My 9-year-old and I were talking about that the other day, and I think he feels qualified as well if you set the bar at that level. But we have a great opportunity in Minnesota right now to turn the corner to the right side. And I don't mean politically right, but I am genuinely concerned about the direction of all government all the time, government-based solutions on everything, suffocating taxes and regulations. I want my kids and my grandkids to live in a Minnesota we can be proud of.
Jeff Johnson.
We're all friends up here, but I wouldn't be running if I didn't think I was the strongest candidate. And I say that because I believe that I am the candidate who is both endorsable and broadly electable in this race. Endorsable because I have an impeccable conservative record, and I think the straw poll results at State Central a couple months ago showed that I'm very endorsable. But none of that matters if we don't pick somebody who can actually connect with non-Republicans. And I think if you look at my history, particularly in garnering votes in Hennepin County, which has largely abandoned us as Republicans, that would suggest I'll be strong more broadly.
Rob Farnsworth.
I believe that I would be the best governor candidate because we need to think outside the box. When we're looking at who we're going to select, We constantly go to the same sources, to the legislature, to other areas, to pick Republican candidates. We need to think outside the box and pick a candidate that can relate to everybody in Minnesota. I am a normal middle class person. I'm a teacher. My wife's a nurse. It doesn't get more normal than that. We also need a candidate that can win, that can actually reach out to those 75 counties that voted in favor of the marriage amendment in Minnesota. Those are 75 conservative counties with low voter turnout that we need to win.
Dave Thompson.
Certainly we need somebody with the right vision. And just as importantly, we need somebody who has the ability to talk to folks about that vision in a way that we can get more than all of the Republicans. And I believe I have the right vision, and I've demonstrated that to you through my voting record and the things that I've advocated for in the legislature. I've been blessed to have the opportunity on radio and TV and doing other things to talk to all Minnesotans, not just Republicans, about the kinds of things we believe in and convince them. I have the willingness to go door to door, face to face, and talk to people, look them in the eye, and convince them that I care about the issues that are important to them. And with that, I can get elected, I believe.
And finally, Scott Honor.
Well, our Republican leaders have talked a good game, but have not passed our agenda. And I want to apply the skills I developed in business to lead this state, and to do so by using the same skills we used in turning around businesses, setting a vision, creating a specific action plan, and forming a team to get the job done.
Okay, next question, and this time we'll start at the opposite end of the table with Scott Honor and just work our way down. This pertaining to a specific issue, a local government aid was designed to help small outstate communities pay for essential services such as fire and police. There's always talk about reforming it. What specific methodologies would you apply to reform it, Scott Honor?
Well, I think we have to look at our entire budget and set priorities. One of the things that I've seen lacking in Republican leaders is an understanding of what is going on in the budget as a whole. Local government aid is clearly an area that we need to reduce spending and get back to the core original concept of helping some out-of-state areas that really need some additional help, not helping Minneapolis get more water fountains.
Dave Thompson.
Well, local government aid is by its nature a wealth redistribution program, and therefore I'm highly suspect of it to start with. But if we go back to the beginning and we look at the core of what it was intended to do, and that was to provide a method by which towns and cities that were so small that they had an insufficient tax base to provide their basic infrastructure could do so, that we would help with those. The idea that now political power has accumulated within the central cities so that the biggest beneficiaries are of local government aid are Minneapolis, St. Paul, and Duluth, we at the very least have to take it back to its original purpose and stop subsidizing cities that don't need it.
Rob Farnsworth?
I believe that the state government has three fundamental purposes: education, transportation, and public safety. Two of those purposes, transportation and public safety, are areas that should be covered by local government aid. Again, I think that most services should be done by the county. I don't know specific reforms to the actual formula that we use, but we need to make sure that we don't reduce that local government aid to such a point that our outstate counties and cities are not safe and do not have a usable transportation system.
Jeff Johnson.
I think LGA is similar to so many government programs that are intended to help people but then actually hurt them because they create a dependency that we can never get off, whether it's a welfare program or a subsidy or something like LGA. My goal would be to limit LGA to the cities that need it to provide core functions like fire and police and roads and maybe sewer and water.
Finally, Marty Seifert.
Well, I grew up near a town of 100 people in local government aid, but not for local government aid. They wouldn't have had the streets with gravel on them because the average income in my hometown is less than $30,000 a year. A majority of the people are on Social Security. That's what local government aid was for. As a Republican candidate, a lot of people in the rural areas are suspect that they can trust the candidate for governor to be sympathetic. And I am automatic credibility on that because that's where I grew up and that's where I live. It's for core functions. It is not for what's turned out to be an urban welfare program.
Okay. As we are constantly reminded by the mainstream media, we are a purple state, But since we're at a Republican Party event, we're also bidden to remember it's we're told the party keeps getting redder and redder. Do you think that the Republican Party endorsement is a help or a hindrance given current conditions here in Minnesota? And what do you think, what do you plan on doing regarding that? We'll start with Scott Honor.
Well, I'm looking forward to this endorsement process and to the caucuses on February 4th. We're working hard to get folks to come to those caucuses and support me. And I like the fact that it starts early and has the dialogue going on now. We need more people engaged in the dialogue of how we make this state better. I understand that Marty Seifert and Kurt Zellers have said they're definitively going to a primary, so we're also going to see a primary. And I'll make sure my campaign is ready to compete in that primary and hopefully as the endorsed candidate.
Dave Thompson.
I believe the endorsement is a help. And I'll come back to one theme that I've had going this entire afternoon. I don't think the people in this room are that dramatically different from Minnesota at large, but the political rhetoric has become poisoned. And that's why, to me, if I get out there and talk to you sincerely about the things I believe, or I go into a quote-unquote hostile audience politically and talk about the things I believe, and we stick with quality education, a healthy economy, shoring up our healthcare system to put decisions back in the hands of doctors and patients, I think we can win and we can get endorsed.
Rob Farnsworth.
I believe that the endorsement process can be very beneficial. In my own experience, I ran in the 8th Congressional District in 2010. I was not endorsed. Chip Kravac was endorsed. I supported Chip. That was the right decision. The convention made the right decision. And with the party behind him, Chip was really able to shock all of Minnesota by winning that race. So I believe that the endorsing process can be and has been very important and very useful.
Jeff Johnson.
Well, one of the reasons I honor the endorsement is not just because I think it's a help, I think it's our best path to victory this year. Because if we are able to unite behind a candidate at the end of May rather than the middle of August, we can spend the summer aiming our fire and our money at one of the worst governors in the United States rather than at each other. And I think that will be the difference between winning and losing in November.
Marty Seifert.
I think the endorsement can be helpful. That's why I've been traveling to over 50 cities since announcing around Thanksgiving time. I have to drive 3 hours and 10 minutes to get to the Twin Cities. And so I see activists all the time in groups of 5 and 10 where I have to drive 7 hours round trip to see those 5 to 10 people. If I didn't believe in the endorsement process, I wouldn't be aggressively seeking it. I am open-minded to a primary, not so open-minded my brains fall out, but open-minded to a primary because we're going to have one anyway. And the reality is that I believe we are going to have a strong candidate at the end of this thing to take on Mark Dayton. I believe I'm that candidate, and I'd seek your vote for endorsement.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. I'm told this will be the final question of the afternoon, and we appreciate all the folks that have come out, and of course to the five of the six declared Republican candidates that are here today. I'm going to go in alphabetical order with this last question, so obviously we'll start with Mr. Farnsworth. Just kind of a general question. Is there one person in particular, whether it be political or non-political, that you feel has been your most vital influence in your foray into politics, Rob Farnsworth?
Do they have to be alive?
No.
Okay. I majored in history in college, and of course my dream was that I was going to become a history teacher and retire after 30-some years as a history teacher, because I love to learn from history. And I am infatuated with Abraham Lincoln. Now, I know there are some people, there are some issues as far as his ability to ignore constitutional rights. But as far as his leadership ability, his ability to do what seemed impossible, I really respect what Abraham Lincoln was able to do.
Thank you. Scott Honor?
Well, the first person who came to my mind was Dr. Charlie Runnels, who's the Chancellor Emeritus of my alma mater, Pepperdine University. He was chancellor for 50 years and really dedicated his life to serving young people. And for me, he was a real inspiration to having an attitude of having had success to now giving back. And I'm appreciative of that.
And Jeff Johnson.
I would have to say both my parents, because while neither of them were overtly political and certainly neither of them ran for public office, they both instilled in me, they hammered in me this thought that you're not allowed to complain about something unless you get out there first and try to fix it. And so that was the reason I ran for the legislature in the first place, and it's really at the heart of why I'm running for governor right now. So I'd say my parents.
Marty Seifert.
I'd say it's a tie between my dad and my father-in-law. They both had eighth grade educations. My father-in-law raised 8 kids. My dad raised 6 kids. Worked hard, played by the rules. To this day, I don't know if my dad was a Democrat or Republican. He was conservative. He served his country in Korea. I don't know what my father-in-law was either. He served in World War II. They came from the philosophy that the government should be a servant, not that the people should be the servant of the government. And I think that's what really models for me in running for governor.
And wrap it up with Dave Thompson.
Well, I've served a lot of people I admire just generally in life, but you asked about in politics, and I'm gonna pick Winston Churchill. And I'll tell you why. When you're sitting in my seat up here, unless you have incredible ego, you feel a sense of humility. And you feel a sense that you're not the perfect person to do this, and that it's an honor to be here. So the reason that Winston Churchill inspires me is he was not a perfect person. But you look at somebody who cared deeply about the people and is willing to stand up for the things that he believes in the face of incredible adversity, he succeeded though he wasn't perfect. And I believe that there's nothing more you can ask of anyone than that.
All right. We're going to go on to our final statements here right now. First of all, before we get to that, I want to thank everyone for coming out here to a Concordia Academy. We'll do all the wrap up here once we get past that. But what I want to do is go through the final statements in geometric order of, no, I made that up. We're going to go reverse alphabetical order just to mix things up here. 2-minute closing statement, and then we'll take a 5-minute break before Brad and I wrap up here. We'll be doing some broadcasting from the stage, so you can stick around for that if you'd like. The debate will be over, but we will go in reverse alphabetical order. Closing statement, 2 minutes, Dave Thompson.
Well, thanks again, everybody, for taking time out of your Saturday to be here. It's been a great opportunity to talk with you. I enjoyed doing this, and I'm looking forward to shaking hands downstairs. I think you have to ask yourself, how do you select the right person to take on, presumably Mark Dayton? And I think you need a few things. First off, you need somebody who does have the right values and beliefs and the right vision. My public record demonstrates that I am truly a conservative and someone who believes in the conservative platform. Secondly, I think you need somebody who not only believes it, but will live it. And I've done the very best that I can to do that. Early on in my time in the Senate, I stood up against leadership when they suggested a budget number that I believed was far too high to start negotiations with the governor. I was the chief author of the Employee Freedom Right to Work legislation and pushed that once again against leadership. I have done the very best I can to promote and advocate for the kinds of things that I say I believe in. And then thirdly, you need somebody who could get elected and be a leader. And I think that I'm somebody who understands Minnesota. I grew up in a single-parent family home after my parents divorced when I was 11. We were middle or lower middle class, and those are the kinds of people that I grew up around and spent time with and made friends with. But I've also had the opportunity through my work and other things to meet all kinds of different people, entrepreneurs and successful business people, people who have been in horrible legal troubles and have needed help getting out of them. So I believe that I understand the people of Minnesota. I believe I understand what we need to make the state better, and I hope that I can connect with folks and talk to them in a way that they'll accept our vision and that we'll get rid of this governor in November and move Minnesota forward. And I ask for your support. I ask for your endorsement. I will honor your endorsement, and it's an honor to be here. Thank you.
Closing statement from Marty Seifert next.
Thank you, Mitch, and thank you all for being here. You know, why should you vote for Marty Seifert as our candidate on the Republican side? I think I'm the best candidate to win the election against Mark Dayton. It is simple as that. I have a proven ability to get the votes of non-Republicans, 60 to 70% in a district carried by Democrats regularly. People like it if you listen and you tell it like it is. And I've done that as a legislator, as someone who's worked, whether it's been a teacher, administration at the hospital, administration at a university. I think people respect that as a lifelong middle-class Minnesotan, that you've got to be able to get the votes of the average butcher, baker, and candlestick maker to get elected. And I've done that. And when I was with 1,500 people in Duluth this last week to talk about the iron mines reopening, you have to pick a side. And that's okay. We had people that came up to me with the hemp mucklucks on and said, we understand you're going to open the mines and we don't like that. We're not going to vote for you. And I said, that's okay. Don't vote for me. The reality is leadership sometimes dictates that you have to take a tough position on different issues. And I've done that. People respect that. Not taking money from lobbyists is important to people. Being honest and ethical in everything that you do. And telling it like it is when you're on stage with Mark Dayton in a very crisp, clear, and articulate way is important, but it's also about listening and putting a good team together. There's a reason Mark Dayton's lieutenant governor is leaving and not running with him again. I told Channel 4, I talk to my lieutenant governor more than Mark Dayton does, and I don't even have one. So the reality is that he is not listening to people that are part of the team. He is just doing his own thing with wandering leadership. We can do that. The average independent and Democrat that I know in Marshall, Minnesota, and across the state as I've campaigned knows that we can do better for our leadership in the state of Minnesota as we move into the 21st century. I'd humbly ask for your vote as we move into caucuses on February 4th.
Up next, Jeff Johnson.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Brad and Mitch and AM 1280 and Concordia and everybody who put this on. I think this was a great event, and thank you all, obviously, for coming today. I mentioned at the beginning that part of what we need to do as Republicans in this state to win is to pick a candidate who has a vision that can actually inspire non-Republicans and convince people who maybe aren't always with us to vote for us, at least this time. Martin Luther King did not have a 12-point plan. He had a dream. He had a vision. And here's the vision that I've been sharing with Minnesotans. I have a vision of a state where our government actually celebrates success rather than punishes it or looks down upon it. And a vision of a state where a great education is available to every single kid in this state. Not a lot of our kids, or not almost all of our kids, but every single kid, regardless of where he or she lives. And it's a state where healthcare decisions are made by patients and by doctors and not by insurance companies and certainly not by government. I have a vision of a state where the principles of economic freedom and individual liberty and personal responsibility and equal opportunity have replaced this obsession with government involvement in everything, and where the least among us, the most vulnerable in our society, are treated with dignity, and we're not just herding them into government programs that often don't work because that's what makes us feel good, but rather we're figuring out ways to give them access to the same private market that we're all in so they can walk on the same level as us rather than some level underneath. And most importantly, I have a vision of a state where we have abandoned this philosophy that the poor are poor and the rich are rich, and the only thing we can do about that is redistribute the wealth. And instead, we are preaching a sincerely held belief every single day that the poor can become middle class and the middle class can become rich, and anyone who starts with nothing can still accomplish anything in this great state. That's the vision I'm sharing with Minnesotans, and I think that is how we're going to win this race. So thank you again for what you do for the party and our cause, and I hope to earn your support.
Up next, Scott Honor.
You know, Minnesota has abundant resources, it has incredible talent, but Minnesota is underachieving her potential. We have a governor in Mark Dayton who defines success as growing government. I'll define success by growing jobs. I want to apply the skills I developed in business to have this state achieve her full potential, and we'll do that by focusing on jobs, education, and getting better results with fewer dollars. I understand what it takes to create jobs because I've created them. I started a company that today has over 150 employees. 3 years ago, I bought a company in Cosmopolis, Washington, that was a shut-down pulp mill owned by Weyerhaeuser that had devastated a company town. We restarted that mill and created over 200 jobs. I'll make sure that our state has more jobs, better jobs, and rising wages by focusing on regulatory reform, an overhaul of our tax system, and making Minnesota a right-to-work state. And I'll focus on making Minnesota a state in which our students have the best chance to pursue a career or go to college. And we'll do that by putting in place a system that gives parents more choice by having dollars follow students, eliminating the tenure system so that schools have the best chance to recruit and reward the best teachers, and get administrative waste dollars wasted in administrative expense into the classroom. And ultimately, I'll apply myself in a way that gets better results for this state and spends fewer dollars, and put Minnesota back on the path to make the Star of the North the Star of the Nation. Thanks so much.
And finally, Rob Farnsworth.
Well, again, I want to thank you for allowing me to come here today. And before I close, I just want to say, please visit www.robfarnsworth.org. I have the belief that we should provide as much detail about what we would do as governor that we can. And I have written position papers, and those can be found on the website. So please check it out. As you're making your decision, please check that out. Is there anybody in here that thinks that we can't afford another 4 years with Governor Dayton? Anybody? A few of you. I don't think we can afford another 4 years with Mark Dayton, and there are four other people in here, I guess counting us, that agree with that. And that's why I'm up here, because I believe that I am the best candidate that can actually reach out to groups that don't traditionally vote Republican. And the way I say that is, I mentioned Chip Cravath earlier, and Chip proved that there is a recipe for success. In the 8th District, Chip got conservative Democrats that came across and voted for him that hadn't voted Republican in 50 years. Chip was a union member. He got the union vote. He was able to expand the Republican base, and he's forever changed the 8th District, so that now this is the 8th District that had not been a toss-up for 50 years is a toss-up, and we have a good chance of winning that seat again. We need a candidate that can expand. We need to stop having this strategy of having statewide candidates that are good, but then we cross our fingers and hope that the independent can take more votes from the Democrat than from us. We need a candidate that can actually win more than 50%. But as I close, I want to ask you this. Since we're at, you know, a church school, this is something that's been on my mind, because I really believe that there's a certain amount of divine activity in life and in our world. And what I'd like it to ask you to do is this. I'd like to ask you, as you're trying to decide which candidate you're going to support, pray, ask for divine guidance. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of the left saying you can't bring religion into politics. We can, and we should. It's important. Whether it leads you to support me or one of the other candidates, we need to seek divine wisdom as we make this decision. Thank you.
I'd like to, we're going to take a break here in a moment here and go to the broadcast. Let's just make a couple quick thank yous. For starters, thanks to all five of the candidates here. Thanks for showing up today. I know it took 3.5 hours to get here from Marshall, but it also took 3 hours to get here from St. Paul with MnDOT working the way it does. I'd like to thank Dr. Reverend Bernard for opening up the facility for us here. It's a gorgeous facility, one of the best remote facilities we've had at the station. So thank you, Concordia Academy. We'd like to thank the crew from AM 1280, Steve, the engineer in the back there. Also, John Osborne, who is a graduate of Concordia Academy. If you look in the hallway, you might even see his senior picture, so look around for that on your way down to the gymnasium, where we're going to have candidates' tables, some meet and greets. You can ask for both intellectual refreshment and literal refreshment. There's coffee and cookies and stuff down there, too, so there's something for everyone. Brain food, real food, something for everyone. Brad and I are going to take a break right now. When we come back, we're going to do a little broadcasting here from the stage, but we'd like to thank you all, most of all, for coming out here today and kicking off the caucus season for all of us here in Northern Ramsey County. So thank you all for showing up. We're going to take a break now. When we come back, some special guests will be joining us here at Concordia Academy on AM 1280 The Patriot, the Northern Alliance Radio Network. Go nowhere unless you're here in the auditorium. You may leave. If you're in the radio audience, stick around. The fun is just beginning.